Morning, everyone. We're going to get started. Everybody will take their seat. Visitors retire behind the rail. We will get this show started. Thank you very much. To give our invocation this morning, the chair recognizes Pastor Terry Oakman of National Temple Baptist Church. He is here today as a guest of Councilman Johnson. I would ask all members, guests, and visitors to please rise.
Let us pray. Dear God, our Father, we thank you again for this day. We thank you for the convening of these city and community leaders and officials. God, we pray that you will continue to guide them and govern them with true wisdom, all those who have authority, that they may execute them in good conscience and in good faith. For the support of the people and the support of our city, we pray, God, your peace be upon them and us all, that all that is done to your glory and for your name. We thank you now, God, even for the occasion in which we've gathered to celebrate the men of Prince Hall Masonry. Thank you for their legacy. Thank you for their work. Thank you for the light that continue to shine. Let they so ever be a continual beacon of light in this dark, dim society. And through your name we do pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor, for those inspiring words. Council will be at ease. Thank you very much, and thank you for those inspiring words. The next order of business is the approval of the journal of the meeting of Thursday, September 29th, 2016, and the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the journal of the meeting of Thursday, September 29th, 2016 be approved.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded that the journal of Thursday, September 29th, 2016 stand approved. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed, ayes have it, and the journal is approved. The next order of business is request for leave of absence, and the chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President. On behalf of the majority, there are no requests for leave of absence today.
Chair, thanks to the gentleman. Chair now recognizes Councilman O'Neill for the minority.
Thank you, Mr. President. On behalf of the Republicans, there are no requests for leave of absence.
Chair, thanks to the gentleman. This time I would like to dispense with the regular order of business, and I would like to thank everyone who has taken time out of their busy day to come down to witness their government in action. We hope your stay here today is a pleasurable one, and more importantly, a knowledgeable one, so much so that you come back again. So again, thank you so much for coming down to visit us today. This time, the chair recognizes Councilman Johnson, who presented a resolution declaring October 6, 2016 to be the Prince Hall Day, with Most Worshipful Grand Master Joseph Jefferson and those accompanying him, please join the councilman at the podium. And joining Councilman Johnson, we have Councilman Jones, Councilman Green, Councilman Heenan. And I believe we also have our illustrious sheriff, Jewel Williams. and our good friend, Councilwoman Janie Blackwell. And Councilwoman Bass.
Today, I'm truly honored and privileged to have the opportunity to honor a fraternity and declare today in the city of Philadelphia, during our 201st Grand Lodge session, Prince Hall Masons Day. It was in 2007, which I decided to join a fraternity that will help shape who I have become as a man. A fraternity that has helped shape my character. A fraternity that has given countless hours of service in helping others, not only in the city of Philadelphia, but also throughout the United States and even throughout this world. And so it's only fitting that the brothers that are standing here with me today will be honored as we embark upon our 201st Grand Lodge session. And I want to thank my council colleagues who are standing with me here today as we present this resolution. And the resolution reads, declaring October the 6th, 2016 to be Prince Hall Day in the city of Philadelphia, honoring the outstanding civic and philanthropic contributions of the Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania throughout Philadelphia and across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, and celebrating the 201st Grand Lodge Session of Prince Hall Masons.
Behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Whereas Prince Hall is widely recognized as the father of Black Masonry, the brotherhood that has helped to initiate, is an important part of Philadelphia's historic landscape since our nation achieved its independence. And today, it has membership of over 300,000 individuals in 4,500 lodges worldwide. And
whereas Prince Hall helped to establish African Lodge number 459 of Philadelphia, the first Masonic Lodge for Black Masons in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, on September 22, 1797. In 1815, African Lodge number 459 joined with other nascent Masonic lodges in Philadelphia to form the first African independent Grand Lodge of free and accepted Masons. This historic ascendant of Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania and
whereas, as the organization grew throughout the United States, the spirit of brotherhood, service, and charity began to truly shine. Prince Hall lodges were being founded in Africa and around the world, and
whereas today the Prince Hall Grand Lodge is involved in countless philanthropic endeavors, giving back to the community and spreading brotherhood across the city of Philadelphia, and
whereas Philadelphia Sheriff Jewel Williams is joining with this council to honor the Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania and extend his sincere appreciation for its contributions to our great city and Commonwealth. Now, therefore, be it
resolved by the Council of the City of Philadelphia on behalf of itself and Philadelphia Sheriff Jewel Williams, that we hereby declare October the 6th, 2016 to be Prince Hall Day here in the city of Philadelphia in honor of the outstanding civic and philanthropic contributions of the Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania throughout Philadelphia and across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, and celebrate the 201st Grand Lodge Session of Prince Hall Masons. Further resolved that an enclosed copy of this resolution be presented to the Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Pennsylvania as evidence of the deep appreciation and sincere sentiments of this legislative body. And on behalf of the City of Philadelphia, I want to say congratulations.
And the chair recognizes the most worshipful Grand Master, Joseph Jefferson, for remarks.
Thank you. Good morning.
Morning.
To Mr. President, Darrell Clark, to the City Council, friends, citizens of Philadelphia, it is an honor and pleasure for me and this illustrious group behind me to stand before you. We thank you, Councilman Kenyatta Johnson, for all that you have done, the Sheriff of Philadelphia. You as well have been a contributor to Prince Hall Masonry in these United States. We are here this weekend. We will be having our annual session, 201 years of Prince Hall Mason in the jurisdiction of Pennsylvania. We will be housing at the Sheraton at 17th, or 201 North 17th Street, I should say, a hotel where we have about 2,500 individuals coming in for our annual conference. This will provide economic affordability to the citizens of Philadelphia. Indeed, we do these things not only for ourselves, but we do it to help the poor, the weak, and those who cannot stand for themselves. Behind me, I have several of my stalwarts that have served this office before me. This side, okay. I have past most worshipful Grand Master Lorenzo Kruger, whom some of you might know because he has his name on a few bridges in Philadelphia. We have past most worshipful Grand Master Herbert Nathaniel Gibbons. Those in law enforcement know who he is, I'm quite sure. Next, we have an educator in the Leonard Alec, past most worshipful Grand Master Leonard Hurd, is an educator in Philadelphia and was the principal of William Pitt. I think that's it. The rest, huh? Oh, yes. Well, I was going to get to introduce those. But, okay, we are also here today. After we leave here today, we are going to distribute gun locks throughout the areas of the downtown. The gun locks are to serve the purpose of those individuals that have their guns and so that a child cannot get them. We want to lock it up so that they cannot hurt themselves or anyone else for gun safety throughout not only just today, but throughout the year and years to come. The immediate people in the back of me, and they took time out to come out of their schedule, are some of the new masters that run this jurisdiction. I'm only one person, but I have over 200 officers throughout this state, and I want to thank them for coming. Thank you so very much for your time and attention, and God bless.
Council duties. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for your attention. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez, who is presenting a resolution recognizing Hispanic Heritage Month. Would Scott Stinrod and those accompanying her please join the Councilwoman at the podium? And joining Councilwoman Sanchez, we have Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Good morning.
Morning.
It's only fitting as we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month that we highlight the many contributions of Hispanics and Latinos throughout the city. This year, we've chosen to, in collaboration with the Restaurant Association, highlight some of the many restaurant establishments in the city of Philadelphia. There are over 600 Hispanic-owned restaurants in the city of Philadelphia. And for that reason, I invited Councilwoman Blondell Reynolds Brown, the former chair of the Arts and Culture, who has always understood the value of jobs in the cultural industry, and the current chair, Councilwoman Bass, because it is about jobs, right?
Yes.
And I want to just say that as for Latinos, we're a mixed race, and there's no better place to see it than in our food. It is fitting that salsa, it is one of the most heavily used ingredients in how we cook, and obviously in our music also, but it is that mixture of our, for many of us, our African descent, the Taino and the Indian influence, and then our Spaniard influence that I think makes for the spiciness in which you see. Some of you would agree that sometimes we're a little too spicy. But it is only fitting, and I really want to thank the Restaurant Association and the many businesses in the city who have really helped the city thrive. And whether it's a Hispanic-owned restaurant, I think of Tequila's, who's celebrating its 30th anniversary. That was actually one of the first restaurant business deals I did when I worked at a community development corporation 30 years ago. When I see the celebration of 30 years of thriving and the rebirth of downtown, whether it's the restaurant that they own, or as we all know, the kitchen help, Hispanics are making a significant contribution to the city of Philadelphia. So I'm very happy to celebrate this today. So with that, declaring September 15th in 2006 through October 15th a Hispanic Heritage Month to honor the role that Hispanics have played and continue to play in the economic, cultural, and social development of our nation. Whereas each year Americans observe National Hispanic Heritage Month by celebrating the histories, cultures, and contributions of American citizens whose ancestors have come from Spain, Mexico, the Caribbean, Central, and South America. And whereas this day, the 15th, is significant as is the anniversary of independence for many Latin American countries like Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua, in addition to Mexico and Chile, which celebrate their Independence Day the 16th and the 18th, respectfully. Also, many of you know Columbus Day, or as we've now pegged, El Día de la Raza, which also falls on October 12th, is within this time frame. The observation started in 1968 by President Lyndon Johnson and was later expanded by President Ronald Reagan in 1988 to take 30 days, and you know us, we keep extending it, 30, 40, 50, into law in 1988 to recognize the Hispanic ancestry and recognize the many accomplishments and contributions made by Hispanics nationwide. And
whereas Hispanics make up a significant portion of the labor force, working as elected officials like our own Councilwoman Maria Quiñones-Sanchez, CEOs, small business owners, entrepreneurs, and homemakers who provide leadership, guidance, and support of the values which strengthen our economy. And whereas Hispanics in the city of Philadelphia are unique leaders and exceptional role models in all professions and have distinguished themselves as smart and wise business owner, creating jobs, paying wages, and demonstrating that they are a positive contributing force in our local communities and neighborhoods. And whereas Hispanics in the city of Philadelphia own more than 600 restaurants in our city, significantly contributing to the local food culture renaissance of the city, a movement that crosses ethnic and social backgrounds. And
whereas Chef Jose Garces, one of the most dynamic and distinguished chefs in the nation and proudly calls Philadelphia home, has been leading Philadelphia's food movement since opening his first of 9 restaurants in the city in 2005. And whereas Hispanic business owners, despite the many risks and personal sacrifices they encounter, continue to be inspirations to their families, employees, and the community, and whose success stories we can learn to emulate. And whereas, when Hispanics succeed, our nation, our state, our region, and our city succeeds, and their potential should only be limited by the breadth of their dreams. Now, therefore, be it
resolved by the Council of the City of Philadelphia that we hereby declare September 15th through October 15th as Hispanic Heritage Month in the City of Philadelphia to recognize the many accomplishments and contributions made by Hispanics and encourage all residents to learn about more about the people who have played such an important role in our history. Thank you.
And the chair recognizes Mr. Steenrod for remarks.
Good morning.
Morning.
Chef Garza sends his apologies that he can't be with you today, so it's my honor to be here on his behalf as the COO of the Garza Group. You know, as a child, Jose spent hours with his beloved grandmother, whom he called Amada, in her kitchen, where he forged a deep-seated love for the cuisine and traditions of the Hispanic community. He later translated this love into a career as a chef and found a home in the beautiful city of Philadelphia. In 2005, Jose brought his passion for what we like to call Latin-inspired hospitality to life with the opening of Amada, a restaurant that he named after his beloved grandmother. Since then, it's been a journey beyond his wildest dreams. As our family has grown throughout Philadelphia and beyond, we continue to seek Jose's leadership and commitment through staying true to our roots of our Hispanic roots of humble beginnings in his grandmother's kitchen. Our goal remains very simple, and that is to bring the very best of Latin-inspired hospitality to each and every guest every day. It remains our humble privilege and honor to serve you and the entire Philadelphia community, and thank you so very, very much for this honor.
Council will be,
Buenas tardes, buenos días, how are you everybody? My name is Judy Susarra Kembo, and I guess I'm new in this community. I don't know too many people here, but I have been in the restaurant business for 12 years. I own the only traditional Venezuelan cuisine, Venezuelan restaurant in Philadelphia. I have been very happy to bring this cuisine to this country. Beautiful Philadelphia people love my food. So I invite everybody to get a little piece of Venezuela wherever you wanted to go and have some Latin cuisine or in the Cuba, Mexican. So enjoy me one of those days. So my place is located in Spring Garden, in Spring Garden, 941 Spring Garden Street. I have been running the restaurant with my husband very successfully. It's the only location I don't have the time to open too many because I'm hand-on. So I'm always cooking. You will find me there, I will take care of you, I will feed you, and you will be living happy. Believe me. So I am very pleased to receive this honorable resolution in the name of the Hispanic Heritage Month, especially recognizing our great Latin restaurants in this beautiful city of Philadelphia. Thank you very much, and I hope to see everybody.
Councilor Bidis. Come on, boy. Thank you very much, and congratulations. Thank you. At this time, the chair recognizes Councilman Squilla, who presents a resolution recognizing Joe Schiavo and Janet Kalter. Would Mr. Schiavo and Ms. Kalter and those accompanying them please join the councilman at the podium? And joining Councilman Squilla, we have Councilman Greenlee, Councilman Don, and Councilman Heenan.
I just want to say today's a special day, and really for Philadelphia, when we honor people, it's so important to realize and what it means to have great civic leaders. And not that we agree with each other all the time or have understandings of what the community needs, but to have community leaders and civic leaders that really care about their neighborhood and care about their community is what makes Philadelphia such a great place. And today we're honoring two people that really not only did walk the walk, but talk the talk. And they use their own resources, their own time, and give back to our city to make it a better place. So today I'm honored to be able to read this resolution along with my members and signed by all members of council, because the civic leaders in our society today deserve a lot of credit. And these are two really very special people that we want to honor. So, as the council reads, honoring and recognizing Joe Schiavo and Janet Kalter for their tireless dedication to the city of Philadelphia and especially their old city neighborhood. Whereas in 1981, Joe Schiavo and his partner Janet Kalter established their furniture and lighting business, OLC, on North 3rd Street in Old City, where they also live. OLC became a significant part of Old City's renaissance. Joe and Janet soon became active in the Old City Civic Association, whose board Joe served for many years. And
whereas Joe and Janet have been highly involved members of the community for the past 35 years, as the neighborhood has experienced tremendous growth and change. They have dedicated thousands of hours to making Old City cleaner and greener. They have helped plant, water, and maintain street trees all over the neighborhood. They started a distinctive dog waste initiative, complete with custom-designed awareness posters and custom-made receptacles, which have become a model for efforts throughout Center City and the River Wards. And
whereas Joe and Janet have donated significant sums of their own money, along with hundreds of hours of labor, to renovating a marquee park, a pocket of park on Arch Street adjacent to the Old City Fire Station, Joe and Janet also served as an unofficial communication leaders in the neighborhood, maintaining a community bulletin board to keep the residents informed of everything that's happening in their neighborhood. And whereas Joe has become the city's preeminent citizens authority on city's new zoning code, which I can attest to, is in my office a lot. He serves as chair of the zoning committee of the Philadelphia Crosstown Coalition, a coalition more than 20 of the city's most active civic associations. Joe is also vice chair of the Central Delaware Advocacy Group, a coalition of 15 community groups dedicated to safeguard the Central Delaware Master Plan. For most of the past decade, he's repeatedly played a key role in shaping and approving legislation impacting the city's new zoning code and Central Delaware zoning overlay. And
whereas Joe is unfailingly civil, polite, and thorough, his unimpeachable character has made him a reliable advocate and trusted by multiple civic groups to represent their interests. He is similarly trusted by members of City Council and the Planning Commission to be an honest broker on behalf of the public. And whereas together Joe and Janet are model citizens for whom Philadelphia should be proud, they have poured their hearts, minds, hands, and financial resources into our city as business owners, residents, and civic leaders. Now therefore be it
further resolved that this engrossed copy of this resolution be presented to Joe Schiavo and Janet Kalter as evidence of the sincere sentiment of this legislative body. Congratulations.
And the chair recognizes Mr. Schiavo and Ms. Kalter for remarks.
Janet and I haven't actually prepared a statement, and a little unusual for me here in council chambers, I may actually be speechless. But thank you all for coming. Thank you for my friends from the Crosstown Coalition, from CDAG and Pennsylvania Horticultural Society who came out to witness this award. Thanks so much.
Thank you. And I know one last thing. Joe is used to speaking, but it's usually that way to us. So now he got a chance to speak to the crowd. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. Councilor Biddies. Congratulations and thank you very much. The next order of business is communications, and the chair requests that the Sergeant of Arms delivers the messages from the mayor to the chief clerk. Thank you, Mr. Decker. Please read those messages.
To the President and members of the Council of the City of Philadelphia, I am pleased to advise you that on September 29, 2016, I signed the following bill, which was passed by Council at its session on September 29, 2016, Bill Number 160708AAA, and that on October 4, 2016, I signed the following bill, which was passed by Council at its session on September 22, 2016, Bill Number 160330A, and I am transmitting for the consideration of your honorable body a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Greenwich redevelopment area identified by house number and street address as 2114 South 7th Street, and a resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Cecil B. Moore Avenue urban renewal area identified by house numbers and street addresses as 1620 through 24 Cecil B. Moore Avenue and 1626 Cecil B. Moore Avenue, and an ordinance authorizing the revision of lines and grades on a portion of City Plan Number 16S by striking from the City Plan the southeasterly 28 feet wide unopened portion of Grays Ferry Avenue from Carpenter Street to Kimball Street and from Kimball Street to a point approximately 168 feet southwestwardly therefrom in order to conform more closely with existing conditions, all under certain terms and conditions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Decker. Do you have any additional communications?
I have none, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. Our next order of business will be the introduction of bills and resolutions. And the chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Good morning, Mr. President. Morning. I offer one resolution.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A privilege resolution commemorating October 17th, 2016 as Juror Appreciation Day in the City of Philadelphia.
And that will be in this week's final passes calendar. The chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. On your behalf, I offer one resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
A non-privileged resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Cecil B. Moore Avenue urban renewal area identified by house numbers and street addresses as 1620 through 24 Cecil B. Moore Avenue and 1626 Cecil B. Moore Avenue.
Next week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President. I have four bills, two on your behalf.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance to amend section 14, chapter 14300 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Administration and Procedures by modifying the public notice requirements and making related changes, and an ordinance establishing a no-truck parking regulation on both sides of Frankfurt Avenue from Norris Street to Tyson Avenue, and an ordinance amending chapter 16400 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Vacant and Surplus Properties by incorporating all irrevocable power of attorney in all deeds, and
good. Thank you. Those four bills.
It's three.
Okay. Those three bills just read by the Chief Clerk will be referred to the appropriate committee.
And a privilege resolution authorizing Council's Committee on Fiscal Stability and Intergovernmental Cooperation to hold hearings regarding the City's role in tracking, quantifying, and evaluating the costs and health benefits of tax expenditures.
And that resolution will be on today's final passage calendar. The Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have two bills and two resolutions, one privilege, one non-privilege, co-sponsored by Heenan, Gim, Johnson, Bass, Dom, and yourself.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance providing for the submission of the qualified electors of the City of Philadelphia of an amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter establishing a criminal justice reinvestment fund to reinvest savings from a reduced prison population into criminal justice reform programs.
And that will be referred to committee.
And an ordinance to amend the Philadelphia zoning maps by changing the zoning designations of certain areas of land located within an area bounded by Lincoln Drive, Wissahickon Avenue, Schoolhouse Lane, the Oak Road, Midvale Avenue, Crescent Avenue, and Gypsy Lane.
And that will also be referred to committee.
And a privilege resolution recognizing and honoring Please Touch Museum on its 40th anniversary of being an iconic champion of childhood learning and an extraordinary place for children to explore and learn.
And that will be on this week's final passes calendar.
And a non-privilege resolution proposing an amendment to the Philadelphia Home Rule Charter to provide for the creation of a criminal justice reinvestment fund to reinvest savings from a reduced prison population into criminal justice reform programs.
And that will be referred to committee. And the chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
Council President, I have one privileged resolution with the primary sponsor, Councilman Allen Durham, Councilman Bobby Heenan, and signed on by all members of council.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privilege resolution recognizing, congratulating, and honoring Ryan Howard for his 12 seasons with the Philadelphia Phillies.
And that will be on this week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have one non-privilege resolution.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A non-privilege resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds conveying conditional fee simple title to certain city-owned lots and pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 19th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
And that'll be on next week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Today I introduce one non-privilege resolution. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A non-privileged resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds conveying conditional fees simple title to certain city-owned lots and pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements thereon, situated in the 6th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
And that will be on next week's final passes calendar. The Chair recognizes Councilman Green.
Good morning, Council President. I have two privileged resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privileged resolution honoring East Mountain Area neighbors on the occasion of its 50th anniversary.
That will be on this week's final passes calendar.
And a privilege resolution honoring Mount Airy Learning Tree on the 35th anniversary of its founding.
Also on this week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Parker.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have no bills or resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Don.
Thank you, Council President. Today I have one privilege resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
A A privilege resolution honoring and recognizing the Philadelphia Flyers on their 50th anniversary and acknowledging the 2016-17 hockey season as the 50th anniversary season of the Philadelphia Flyers hockey.
And that will be on this week's final passes calendar. The chair recognizes Councilwoman Gibb.
Good morning, Council President. Morning. I have two non-privileged resolutions today.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
A non-privileged resolution condemning Chestnut Hill College for seeking exemption from anti-discrimination laws in its appeal to the Commonwealth Court following a finding of probable cause of racial discrimination by the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission in defiance of its obligation to respect the civil rights of its students and employees and urging the college to withdraw its appeal.
And that will be on next week's final passage calendar.
And a non-privileged resolution calling on Congress to immediately rectify the injustice of the 1996 immigration laws by restoring due process to immigration procedures, ending automatic deportation, and discontinuing mass detention in order to uphold human rights and dignity in the United States immigration system.
That will also be in next week's final passes calendar. And the chair recognizes Councilman Taubenberger.
Good morning, Council President and colleagues. I have no bills or resolutions this morning.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have no bills or resolutions.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. I have two bills and one privileged resolution.
Thank you, Councilman.
An ordinance establishing a no-truck parking regulation on both sides of Greenwood Street from 2nd Street to 3rd Street.
And refer to committee.
And an ordinance establishing a no-truck parking regulation on both sides of 8th Street from Bainbridge Street to Fitzwater Street.
Refer to committee.
And a privilege resolution designated the week of Monday, October 3 through Monday, October 10, 2016 as Christopher Columbus Italian-American Heritage Week in the city of Philadelphia. This is done in celebration of the festivities commemorating Columbus's historic voyage to the New World and honoring Danny Aiello as Grand Marshal of the 2016 Philadelphia Columbus Day Parade.
And this week's final passes calendar, the chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. I offer two bills and one resolution, and I'd like to be heard after the resolution.
Thank you, Councilwoman.
Thank you.
An ordinance amending Chapter 19-3500 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Hospital Assessments to make changes to conform to state laws, including by providing an exemption for certain cancer hospitals.
Referred to committee.
And an ordinance amending Chapter 19-200 of the Philadelphia Code entitled City Funds, Deposits, Investments, Disbursements by revising the list of city depositories.
And referred to committee.
And a privileged resolution authorizing the Joint Committees on Public Health and Human Services and Licenses and Inspections to hold hearings and calling on the Department of Licenses and Inspections, Department of Health, and Pennsylvania Liquor Control Board to investigate stop-and-go establishments that violate restaurant liquor license requirements.
And that will be on this week's final passes calendar. Ms. Decker, will you want to read that resolution again, please?
A resolution authorizing the Joint Committees on Public Health and Human Services and Licenses and Inspections to hold hearings and further calling on the Department of Licenses and Inspections, Department of Health, and Pennsylvania Liquor Control Board to investigate stop-and-go establishments that violate restaurant liquor license requirements.
Thank you. That'll be on next week's final passes calendar. Chair recognizes Councilman Ellis.
Thank you very much. I offer one privilege resolution co-sponsored by council members Don Greenlee, Jones, Green, Bass, Taubenberger, and Parker. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman.
A privilege resolution recognizing and honoring Philadelphia Mayor Joseph Watson for rescuing African-American children who were kidnapped from Philadelphia.
And that will be on this week's final passage calendar. Thank you. That concludes our introduction of bills and resolutions today. We have no reports from committee, so the next order of business is the consideration of the calendar. Being no bills on the first reading calendar, the chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee. You got it? Chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee for the purpose of calling up bills and resolutions on the final passage calendar today.
Thank you, Mr. President. The following bills and resolutions are being called up on the final passage calendar today. Numbers 160846, 160850, 160855, 160859, 160365A, 160767, and 160713. All their bills and resolutions are being held.
Thank you, Councilman. Before considering these bills and resolutions on the final passage calendar today, we will have our public comment session. The public comment session will go as follows. If you are interested in testifying on a bill or resolution that is on the final passage today, if you have not already done so, you sign up at the table to my left. When your name is called, you will go to the middle of the council chambers. There is a podium with a device. That device has a green light on it. When the light turns green, it will be time to speak. When the light turns yellow, you will have 30 seconds to conclude your remarks. When the light turns red, we'd ask that you please adhere to the guidelines and conclude your remarks. You will be given 3 minutes to speak on the bill or resolution. Mr. Decker, please call the first name.
Nikio Saval. Commenting on 160850.
Good morning.
My name is Nikhil Saval, and I'm a member of Reclaim Philadelphia. I am here today to urge Council to pass the resolution introduced by Councilman Johnson opposing the Trans-Pacific Partnership. In doing so, Philadelphia would join dozens of cities, Seattle, San Francisco, Pittsburgh, and New York City, in opposing a deal negotiated in secret, written by corporations for corporations, which, if passed, would exacerbate the power of elites at the expense of working people all across the deal's member states and the world at large. The resolution would send a powerful message to the local congressional delegation and the country at large that Philadelphia stands with workers against the deal. Today, I single out for censure one special and crucial provision of the TPP, the Investor State Dispute Settlement, or ISDS, provisions. Modeled after the North American Free Trade Agreement, these wide-ranging laws allow a foreign company to sue the United States in a form of corporate arbitration outside of U.S. courts when that company feels its profits are threatened by regulations. This mechanism puts at risk nearly every form of U.S. regulation. Financial, environmental, land use, and labor protections could all be at risk. Using ISDS provisions, for example, offshore corporations have the right to sue the U.S. for upholding the Clean Water Act, as well as many other host state regulations that might negatively impact their profits. Locally, the Green Cities Clear Waters Program, which is creating a green stormwater infrastructure and working class jobs, is also at risk from the TPP. ISDS provisions threaten local zoning ordinances. For example, should a multinational waste management plant on the Schuylkill be determined to pose a threat to the city's water supply, rezoning to move it could also lead to ISDS lawsuits. Minimum wage laws, occupational health and safety laws, there is practically no regulatory area, no measure of municipal sovereignty that is not under threat from the TPP. It would have a chilling effect on any attempt to pass local regulations of this kind. These are only a few of the reasons why the TPP is bad for Philadelphia and bad for the country. I hope Council will do the right thing by its city and its workers and adopt this resolution. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony.
Shane Razzie. Commenting on 160850.
Morning.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Shane Razzie. I'm a member of Reclaim Philadelphia, and I was born and raised in Port Richmond. I'm anaphylactically allergic to dairy. That's including but not limited to milk, cheese, whey, butter, and casein. These are all things that are commonly found in most foods. And I joke that I'm going to run out of my nine lives one of these days, but I've actually been in a hospital, my throat closing, purple skin, blown up like a balloon, clinging to life more times than I can count. Every bite that I take or sip that I drink is like a game of Russian roulette. EpiPens have the power to keep me alive for 15 minutes while someone rushes me to the hospital. The price of EpiPens are already outrageously high, and if the TPP passes, they could skyrocket even more. Currently, I need two EpiPens close at all times, plus I need one at my girlfriend's house, my mom needs one, my friends need one, I need one at work, I need one at school. Already at $300 to $600 a pop, that's way too much for anyone to afford. I have insurance for now, but there are many average Americans who have to choose between this life-saving medication and putting food on the table or paying their mortgage that month. Plus, EpiPens expire in a year, so that's a constant expense. The TPP will allow corporate giants like Mylan to keep raising prices of this and many other medications at the expense of your constituents. Innocent people will choose to go without. They could very easily die a terribly painful, uncomfortable, and undignified death because someone thought profits were more important than the people. I, along with the rest of our city, need you to stand with us against this monster trade deal that will most definitely hurt the families that you were chosen to protect. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you for your testimony.
Joe Danahel, commenting on 160745, 160850, 160846, and 160855.
Same bad time, same bad channel. Every week I am here. It is criminal, this council's callous disregard of 42 U.S.C. 1982, 1983, 1985, 1986, 18 U.S.C., 2381, 2384, and constitutional violations in addition. The supreme law of the Commonwealth, the PA Constitution, states Article 1, Section 1, all men are born equally free and have certain inherent and indefeasible rights, among which are defending liberty, acquiring and possessing and protecting property. Section 6 says, trial by jury shall heretofore and the right thereof remain inviolate. Your oaths of office require every public agent to defend and uphold federal and state constitutions and laws, then how does my decree go unanswered? Why is the council continuing to do business as usual? The official decree requires immediate action to defund the federal or the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority, Sheriff's Department, District Attorney's Department, Department of the Comptroller immediately for failing to act to remedy for the theft of 1038 West Wyoming Avenue. The council officers, the mayor, the city have motioned more than once in open court to deny my right to jury trial. This is a complete violation of the multitudes of laws, Article 1, Section 11 of the PA Constitution. The court shall be open, and every free man for injury done him in lands, goods, person, or reputation shall have a remedy by due course of law.
It is criminal for this body to defy the rule of law and an official decree of the people. I see your eyes wandering, Council President. Obviously, you still don't give a crap.
Thank you for your testimony. Mr. Decker, before you end, Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Yeah, thank you very much, Council President. I just want to, on a point of order, provide just some information concerning the first two witnesses and the statement, which is not actually correct. The Investor State Dispute Settlement, ISDS, we, as in the United States, we're already party to 51 agreements, not a new organization or entity. We have never lost a case in front of the ISDS, and that's because the ISDS provides the basic protections against discrimination and other things that are in the Constitution, such as expropriation without compensation to both domestic and foreign companies, investors, and other folks. TTP simply extends that protection that is provided in the U.S. to participating countries, of which there are 12. So that is just a correction to the record. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Mr. Decker?
There are no other speakers on the public comment list, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. We will now move to our calendar. And Mr. Decker, can you please read the title of 160846?
A resolution authorizing the Commissioner of Public Property to execute and deliver to the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority without consideration deeds can bank additional fees, simple title to serve city on lots of pieces of ground with the buildings and improvements are on, situated in the 47th Ward of the City of Philadelphia.
Chair recognizes Councilman Greenlee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. Resolution 160846 is adopted. Mr. Decker, 160850.
A resolution urging the United States Congress to reject the proposed Trans-Pacific Partnership due to the agreement's negative impact on workers' rights in the United States and across the world, and calling on the Pennsylvania Congressional Delegation to unite in opposition to the agreement's ratification.
Before we call for the motion, the Chair recognizes Councilman O. I'm sorry, O'Neill. Councilman O'Neill, did you want to?
You say Councilman O.
I'm saying I made a mistake. Councilman O'Neill.
Okay, thank you.
There's so many Republicans on the council, I get mixed up. You know,
we just set this up to try to trick you. Okay. With all due respect to my colleague, and I'd support him on anything he does, and I have in his district. He does great work. But I just think that, you know, I made a decision a long time ago not to run for Congress. Spend a day down there, and you probably would agree with me. Maybe a couple hours even. But I do believe that while we could have hearings on this probably for a week, you know, hundreds of people, thousands of hours, whose job it is to do these treaties and international agreements, have spent all this time. We come in here, we get a page. All the whereases are assumed to be factual. I'd probably be against this treaty if I were in Congress, but I'd have to know a whole lot more than I know today. So I'm going to vote against it for those reasons. I just think it's way beyond our scope. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Taubenberger. You want to speak on that?
Just for one brief moment, and I concur with Councilman O'Neill, and that I would also like to be recorded as a no vote on that motion.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. Councilman O, you want to come back?
Well, I wasn't going to say anything, but now I'm going to have to. And I did speak to my friend Councilman Johnson, who I support in every which way. You know, I will agree with Councilman O'Neill. This issue, because I chair the Global Opportunities Creative Innovative Economy Committee, I felt it was I should look into this matter. And I have spoken to various experts, including the U.S. Ambassador to Vietnam and the U.S. Ambassador to Brunei. And from what I can understand, there are two competing treaties. The U.S. treaty would be TPP. That would be Asian countries, and it would be U.S.-led with a lot of very good provisions, including no child labor, collective bargaining in foreign countries. Every country that would sign on would have to allow collective bargaining, which would actually increase the cost of labor in those countries and benefit the U.S. These are countries that are friends of ours. They want to be part of TPP with the U.S. because there is a competing treaty. That China-led treaty is called RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And so if we don't do TPP, we will end up with RCEP. That China-led treaty is quite different from ours and would be detrimental to U.S. interests. I also would say that the Congressional Research Service did a, and that is from the Library of Congress, it's neutral, they did a extensive job of researching, and they found that the Tufts report, which its very negative estimations, was unconventional, has come under great criticism, and they stated that the Tufts model uses very little trade data and lacks important details. Then the U.S. International Trade Commission performed an independent analysis of international trade issues resulting from TPP, and they concluded that TPP would boost both U.S. employment and GDP. And particularly here in Philadelphia, it would be beneficial to us. There are winners and losers in this, Council President, and the losers are going to be on the side of persons who have less education, less skills. And so I do understand why there's concern over TPP. The thing I would say is those jobs are being challenged simply by the fact that other countries are employing better technology, educating their population, and are competing with us. So 87% of manufacturing job loss in the U.S. over the last 10 years was not because of lower wages, but because of the implementation of technology abroad. So I will be voting against the resolution based on the fact that I do understand that at least the trade experts and others seem to agree with President Obama that TPP is good for the country. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones. Council, I was just holding up on you because you're going to make the motion.
So I respect my colleagues, particularly nobody can be an expert on everything in this body. So we tend to lean and draw upon each other when we dive deep into an issue or a phase of expertise. But there are very rare times when we really disagree with our Republican colleagues. We may not always say it because, you know, we have to keep up our DNR, our registrations, but this time we have a deep disagreement. TTP is trumped up, trickle-down economics. And at the end of the day, the people at the lower rung in the city of Philadelphia wind up losing jobs. We used to be the center for garment manufacturing. We used to be the center of, my grandfather walked out of high school, Central, and walked right into a job that was a wage-earning, family-supporting income. The more we tend to export these opportunities, the folk at the bottom of the rung, trying to get their first leg up into a society, wind up being the losers. So you talk about winners and losers, I understand that there are winners and losers. I don't want them to be in my district. I don't want them to be folk that used to be employed because they're you know, whether it's Tasty Cake or whatever is now being produced in a foreign country. To the degree that we can keep wage-earning, family-supporting jobs in Philadelphia, we should be involved right here in letting our voice be known about these kinds of impacts. And so we can't just ignore it. If we ignore it, it will not ignore us. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair, one more time, recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you, Council President. Oddly, Donald Trump is quite against TPP, so it's not trumped up. The other thing is that, you know, our city has lost 223,000 jobs in total between 1970 and 2010. Between 1960 and 1990, our city has lost 300,000 manufacturing jobs. That wasn't because of treaties. That was because of competitiveness and other issues. There are treaty issues involved, but the net for America has been plus in terms of jobs and surplus in trade whenever we've had a treaty. So the issue that I would say is this, that as the U.S. continues to grow and as other countries improve their economic condition, their education, healthcare and other things, they too begin to look at the environmental concerns, healthcare, collective bargaining and other issues. The challenge for us is whether we can stop the world from progressing or whether we meet the challenge, as we have done time and time again, to lead the world in education, innovation and productivity. So that for me is the kind of critical issue, but at the same time, the rest of the world is forming treaties. You're going to be with TPP or you're going to be the victim of RCEP. It's either U.S.-led with all our concerns about democracy, equality, and the rule of law, or you're going to be China-led, and that's going to be a challenge for us and probably the loss of more jobs to Americans. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair, again, recognizes Councilman Jones.
To my good friend and colleague, who we share a great many things with, as chair of City Council's Economic Development and Committee and Commerce Committee, we have shared projects such as Rotem, brought them from Korea, created 300 jobs. I support that because it's right here, creating wealth and opportunity right here. I try to correct you. It is trumped up economic still because my father told me, don't watch what I say, watch what I do. And most of his products are produced outside of Philadelphia, outside of the United States, and elsewhere, wherever he can get an exploitive opportunity to produce it. So trumped up economics by any other name is still a rose. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, sir. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez.
I had a conversation with Councilman O, and I appreciate the value of us being in an international market. But I'll only use Puerto Rico as an example because when NAFTA and CAFTA came to be, Puerto Rico had 200,000 more pharma-allied jobs than it does today. And the reason is that in American soil, we follow EPA standards, OSHA standards, minimum wage standards. And in the global market, as has been highlighted, child labor and a bunch of other issues are exploited. American-born Puerto Ricans could not compete with Mexico and other places, and we've watched the pharmaceutical industry leave. And the devil's always in the details. It is not just the treaty, but it is what are the IRS standards that allows these companies to make money, take the money out with no taxes, and move that money around within their global industries. So, you know, I do think council has a role in playing in voicing our concerns around these issues because it does impact us. In a city where we've tried to protect manufacturing and be globally competitive, it is important to us. But the devil's always in the details. And just to add, you know, you can't highlight more when Trump says that he's smart because he knows how to bypass our IRS code. That
that's where the details fall. It's how this income that is generated and how workers are treated lead to the exploitations by big corporations. So don't have to look far. There's 200,000 people that are unemployed in Puerto Rico now as a result of NAFTA and CAFTA. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
Thank you, Council President, and I do not want to belabor the treaty trend that we happen to be on. I think the TPP has gotten more conversation in this body than it has in the national debates, but what I am enjoying about this, even though it's been a long topic of conversation, is this discussion is bringing us back to our core values of putting people to work here in the city of Philadelphia. All right, this is the end of National Manufacturing Week, and we are visiting manufacturers and CTE programs all throughout the city of Philadelphia. I encourage everybody to make it here, utilize our supplier network that we have with our universities, with our city and our commodities and our purchase buying power that we have, and let's form this back into our procurement process, which I think is a major focus of this body. And let's concentrate on getting local people, local business, local jobs, and utilizing the supplier network that we do have here that does exist, so we can lift some of our people that live here in the city that's in poverty, 27% poverty, and increase our graduation rate, support some of the initiatives like yourself and Councilman Jones with trying to reduce our prison population and getting people back to work and reduce our recidivism rates. So, it is about humanity. It is about dignity. It is about respect of the products that we produce. It is about educating our kids to be the future, right? And it is our responsibility to be smart about that. And we may not have control over what Congress does in its totality, right? But we do have a voice, and we do have a responsibility to stick up for the people of the city of Philadelphia and keep it a priority and to work smart together collectively. So I want to thank, sponsor in this kind of spirited conversation. All right, this is not and should not be a party line issue. All right, putting people to work and making it here and utilizing our supplier network, again for the third time, as I stated here, all right, is our responsibility to try to put in the forefront in Philadelphia. So thank you for the conversation.
Thank you, Councilman. Okay, we now recognize Councilman Johnson for a motion on the resolution.
Council President, I just want to just make a brief,
absolutely,
couple brief remarks, and for the most part, my colleagues have already summed up my position, but just a couple of facts. According to the Brookings Institute, NAFTA was started on a promise that they would create 200,000 new jobs. In reality, we lost 683,000 jobs. The same thing with the U.S.-Korea Free Trade Agreement. There was a promise that they would create 71,000 new jobs. In reality, they lost 40,000 jobs. And so for me, this is about focusing on a treaty that's right now being done in secrecy. Like, the whole negotiation is behind closed doors. There is no public input at this particular point in time. And so for me, as a city, if we're going to support such a treaty, then we should have an opportunity to have input that specifically deals with workers' rights and making sure that we aren't supporting corporations expanding their profits on the back of workers, rather it's within the United States or in other countries. We have no problem with doing businesses with other countries, but for the most part, the reason why our country has lost so many businesses, because after NAFTA, most of the major corporations went to go get free, cheap labor outside of America. And so I think in this particular case, we need to proceed with caution, and I ask all my colleagues to affirmatively vote for the resolution.
Can we get a second?
Second.
Been moved and properly second. I better hurry up. Councilman? Never mind. All right.
Thank you, President Clark. I think everybody said already what we need to say, and I don't think we need to belabor it any longer. So I think we'll have a vote. Second.
Thank you. Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded. All in favor of Resolution 160850, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Ayes have it. Resolution 160850 is adopted. Thank you. Mr. Decker, can you please read this out of 160855?
A resolution approving the redevelopment contract of the Philadelphia Redevelopment Authority for the redevelopment and urban renewal of a portion of the Whitman urban renewal area identified by house number and street address is 2127 South 6th Street.
Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second. It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor say aye. Those opposed, ayes have it. Resolution 160855 is adopted. Mr. Decker, 160859.
A resolution urging the United States Department of Defense to include the names of the 74 fallen sailors of the USS Frankie E. Evans on the Vietnam Veterans Memorial, including Philadelphia native Patrick Michael Corcoran.
Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you. Move for the option of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it. Resolution 160859 is adopted. Mr. Decker, please read the title 160365A.
An ordinance amending subcodes A and PM of Title IV of the Philadelphia Code by establishing a separate offense for certain chronic, non-compliant violators of the Property Maintenance Code.
This bill has been heard on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass. Councilwoman Blackwell. Councilman Dom. Councilman Green. Councilman Greenlee. Councilwoman Gim. Councilman Heenan. Councilman Johnson. Councilman Jones. Councilman O'Neill. Councilman O. Councilwoman Parker. Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez. Councilwoman Reynolds Brown. Councilman Squilla. Councilman Taubenberger. Council President Clark.
Aye. The ayes are 17 and nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in the affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, can you please read the title of 160767?
An ordinance authorizing the bond committee to sell bonds at public or private negotiated sale to provide funds toward various capital municipal purposes, providing for appropriations to the Sinking Fund Commission for the payment of such bonds, authorizing agreements to provide credit or payment or liquidity sources for the bonds in connection with issuance of the bonds, and certain other actions.
This bill had been heard on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass. Councilwoman Blackwell. Councilman Dom. Councilman Green. Councilman Greenlee. Councilwoman Gim. Councilman Heenan. Councilman Johnson. Councilman Jones. Councilman O'Neill. Councilman O. Councilwoman Parker. Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez. Councilwoman Reynolds Brown. Councilman Squilla. Councilman Taubenberger. Council President Clark.
Aye. The ayes are 17 and nays are 0. Majority of members present voting in affirmative, the bill passes. Mr. Decker, 160713.
An ordinance amending section 17107 of the Philadelphia Code entitled Contractors, Labor Management Relationships to provide that building service employees performing labor under certain building service contracts receive the prevailing wage and prevailing working conditions and to provide for certain exemptions or exclusions.
Thank you. This bill has been heard on two separate days. The question is, shall the bill pass finally? Mr. Decker, call the roll.
Councilwoman Bass. Councilwoman Blackwell. Councilman Dom. Councilman Green. Councilman Greenlee.
Aye.
Councilwoman Gim.
Aye.
Councilman Heenan.
Aye.
Councilman Johnson.
Aye.
Councilman Jones.
Aye.
Councilman O'Neill.
Aye.
Councilman O.
Aye.
Councilwoman Parker. Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez.
Aye.
Councilwoman Reynolds Brown. Councilman Squilla.
Aye.
Councilman Taubenberger.
Aye.
Council President Clark.
Aye. The ayes are 17 and nays are 0. Majority of members present voting for the bill passed. Thank you. Mr. Decker, do you have any additional resolutions?
A resolution commemorating October 17, 2016 as Juror Appreciation Week in the City of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Chair recognizes Councilwoman Reynolds Brown.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move for the adoption.
Second. Been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed, the ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution authorizing Council's Committee on Fiscal Stability and Intergovernmental Cooperation to hold hearings regarding the City's role in tracking, quantifying, and evaluating the costs and benefits of tax expenditures, introduced by Councilman Heenan on behalf of Council President Clark.
Chair recognizes Councilman Heenan.
I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second.
Been moved and properly second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed, the ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring Please Touch Museum on its 40th anniversary of being an iconic champion of childhood learning and an extraordinary place for children to explore and learn, introduced by Councilman Jones.
Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. I gleefully move for the adoption.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution recognizing, congratulating, and honoring Ryan Howard for his 12 seasons with the Philadelphia Phillies and commending his dedication to philanthropy throughout the City of Philadelphia, introduced by Councilman Johnson.
Chair recognizes Councilman Johnson.
I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second. It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution honoring East Mount Airy neighbors on the occasion of its 50th anniversary, introduced by Councilman Green.
Chair recognizes Councilman Green.
I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. That resolution is adopted.
And a resolution honoring Mount Airy Learning Tree on the 35th anniversary of its founding, introduced by Councilman Green.
Chair again recognizes Councilman Green.
I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it.
And a resolution honoring and recognizing the Philadelphia Flyers on their 50th anniversary and acknowledging the 2016-17 hockey season as the 50th anniversary season of the Philadelphia Flyers hockey, introduced by Councilman Dom.
Chair recognizes Councilman Dom.
Thank you, Council President. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed, ayes have it, and that resolution is adopted.
And a resolution designated the week of Monday, October 3 through Monday, October 10, 2016 as Christopher Columbus Italian-American Heritage Week in the City of Philadelphia. This is done in celebration of the festivities commemorating Columbus's historic voyage to the New World and honoring Danny Aiello as Grand Marshal of the 2016 Philadelphia Columbus Day Parade, introduced by Councilman Squilla.
Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. Co-introduced by my colleague, Councilman Johnson. I move for the adoption of the resolution.
Second. It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Those opposed? Ayes have it.
And a resolution recognizing and honoring Philadelphia Mayor Joseph Watson for rescuing African-American children who were kidnapped from Philadelphia, introduced by Councilman O.
Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you. I move for adoption of the resolution.
It's been moved and properly second. All those in favor? Come on, guys. Thank you. Those opposed, the ayes have it. The resolution is adopted.
There are no other resolutions on the final passage calendar, Mr. President.
Thank you very much. Are there any speeches on the part of a minority? And the chair recognizes Councilman Taubenberger.
Thank you, Council President. Last week, a very important resolution passed this body. I was very honored to be able to be a sponsor of it. What it really reaffirms, and I like to speak on it personally, is the zero tolerance policy against sexual harassment in the workplace, frankly, any place in Philadelphia. Recently, in my capacity as a board member of the Philadelphia Parking Authority, I made some very inappropriate and sensitive comments to the press regarding former Parking Authority Executive Director Vince Fennerty's admitted sexual harassment of a female worker. I deeply regret my ill-chosen words. In no way did I mean to minimize the seriousness of the sexual harassment against Mr. Fennerty. These words did not reflect how I feel and the values that I hold dear. I am not that person. My mother raised me better than that. I'm a married man and the father of two daughters. I've made several public apologies since uttering these regrettable words, and I would like to take the opportunity to personally apologize to Mayor Kenny and to every member of this city council. I am a human being, and like all of us, I am very fallible, and I beg for your forgiveness. Sexual harassment is a serious issue here and across the country. In the last fiscal year, Equal Opportunity Commission reported that 90,000 charges were received. Fully one-third of these charges included allegations of sexual harassment in the workplace. Sexual harassment is intolerable, unacceptable at any level, and must be abolished from the workplace. This resolution is a timely and decisive step in the right direction, and I thank my colleagues for introducing it and passing it. And I would like to personally pledge to this resolution my personal energies in helping make this a reality. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. Thank you, and apology accepted. Chair recognizes Councilman O.
Thank you, Council President. First, let me just commend Councilman Tom Berger. I think everybody who knows him knows what a gentleman he is, and certainly he has apologized, which that's between him and the voters and the public, but certainly I'd like to just commend him on his courage and forthrightness to step up and once again, you know, just be clear with the public. So thank you very much, you know, it's very much to be commended. Today's an odd day, Council President. I hate to point out that three Republicans have sided with President Obama. So I don't know what's going on here today, but whatever it is, I just want to bring back this my resolution. I just wanted to talk about a little bit because it was just you know, one of my staffers was doing some research and came across Philadelphia Mayor Joseph Watson. He served as mayor from 1824 to 1827, and the remarkable thing he did is he received notification that Philadelphia children, African Americans, were being kidnapped and sold into slavery in the South. And he and the constable, with funding from city council, went out and got those kids back. 10 youth were recovered, and then he acted as the prosecutor. They caught the gang that was doing this. But I just thought, wow, I did not know that. It's one of the wonderful Philadelphia facts about what our government did in this critical time to show leadership and humanity. And I just thought this person should be recognized, Mayor Joseph Watson. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman. Thank you very much. Chair recognizes Councilman O'Neill.
Yes, Mr. President. I appreciate Councilman O pointing out that three Republicans sided with President Obama former Secretary of State Clinton. But I think what's more significant as a story is the 14 Democrats sided with Donald Trump. Thank you.
You gotta love this place, I tell you. It's the best job I've ever had. On behalf of the majority, Councilman, did you want to come back? All right.
Because I am a member of the minority party who has now sided with President Obama. But the reason that I wanted a word was it's always difficult to lose a staff person, particularly one who is doing very, very good work. But to lose that person to the United States Navy is, I think, important for our country. And my scheduler, Andrew Brenner. Andrew, please stand up. He is leaving. He's leaving very shortly for the Officers Candidate School in Newport, Rhode Island. He was given his commission with your permission, President, in this very hall. I think that's very, very important. I just want him to acknowledge to the service he's about to give to our country.
And thank
Andrew,
you.
Thank you very, very, very much.
Thank you. And thank you for your service again. It's a great ceremony. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Quiñones-Sanchez.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just want to highlight the discussion around poverty. I'm really concerned as I've watched the debates unfold and the campaign rhetoric that we're experiencing, that we keep
forgetting the theme around poverty. And that's why the legislation sponsored by Councilwoman Gim today and supported by all of us around closing loopholes and being very targeted at when we subsidize development, we expect development to provide, as Councilman Jones mentioned, family-sustaining jobs. But I'm really concerned, and I want to encourage all of us as we go down to the last 30 days of this election cycle, that we start talking about the issues that are important to us. We as a city continue to experience a decrease of HUD funding, which is vital as we talk about affordable housing in this city, you know, the family-sustaining jobs. And, you know, Councilman O always refers to this issue around adequate education and really preparing a global workforce. I feel like this is getting lost in this debate. And when you represent a constituency that I represent and a constituency that we see in the city of Philadelphia, I think we need to bring that in the forefront. And so since we're getting visited by all of the candidates, let us continue to put that on their radar because there's not enough discussion about what this country is going to do to help women, single mothers, to help support public education, and to have a real robust economic development strategy that allows poor people, working poor, and go from being poor to the working poor and being able to afford a house, and send their children to a publicly funded school that is adequate. So I feel like that's getting lost in this debate, and I just feel like we need to continue to remind ourselves, but more importantly, the candidates that are running for office. So thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Very important note. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Bass.
Thank you, Mr. President. I do want to take a moment for two items today. First, I wanted to recognize that we have a student here with us from Mastery Linfest campus, Ms. Aaliyah Wilson, who's in the 10th grade. Who's in the 10th grade, who is spending the day down here in Council. We hope she'll come back. And she's originally from Southwest Philadelphia, and we are just pleased and proud and honored to have her with us today. Also, earlier, we did introduce a resolution regarding stop-and-go establishments and everybody's favorite topic, particularly those who have been working on this for many, many years, and I wanted to specifically recognize Councilwoman Blondell Reynolds-Brown, who I know has been working on this issue, along with Senator Art Haywood in the Northwest. Councilwoman Maria Quiñones-Sanchez has done significant work, as has Councilman Jones and Johnson, around stop-and-go establishments. And we actually did a tour in my district to see how many of these quote-unquote restaurants do we have in the 8th District, and we found 28 of them, 90% of which don't sell food, even though they call themselves restaurants. So what do they sell? They sell beer. And another quarter of them, 25% of that number, sells liquor. And we think that that number is actually higher because there's some funny business going on with the liquor sales as well. These quote-unquote restaurants, 70% of which don't have tables and chairs, over 90% don't have restrooms, and over 90% do advertise the sale of food on the exterior of the establishment. So our resolution today is actually calling on the Liquor Control Board, along with the Department of Health and L&I, to actually investigate what these establishments are. We know they're not restaurants. We know that they're not bars. But what are they? They're somewhere in some sort of a hybrid in between a liquor store, a beer distributor, and a bar. And we need to better clarify what these establishments are, because children are able to go into these establishments and purchase popcorn or potato chips or candy, which some of them do sell. So that's something that we're really looking into. And also, we'd like for the investigators to look at the distance. These are all pretty much in the same types of neighborhoods. We did an analysis and found that all of these establishments in my district are between a 1 and 6 minute drive, one to another, and that there are approximately 6 per square mile throughout the district. So you have your choice of any of these establishments, and that's not even including the other liquor sales, which would include bars and beer distributors in the neighborhood. So we're really looking forward to this investigation, and I just wanted to bring it to folks' attention. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you so much, Councilwoman, for your diligent work on this. You have 28 in your district. In some cases, I might have that many in one block, I'll tell you. So trust me, it's an issue. I'm so happy that you're taking the initiative to deal with that very, very troublesome issue. Chair recognizes Councilwoman Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I want to thank Councilwoman Bass for working this area and certainly agree with your statement. This, we defined stop and goes from the what was then the Purple Fox at 49th and Baltimore. And all that she says we've been through every now and then the law changes and they take out all we've done. We fought so hard and so long on this very issue. So I'll pull out some of the language and some of the law that we've been through. We did these tours and visited these stop and goes where they still exist. They've come back. The law changes and then we're back where we started with these little windows that are there where children are trying to buy a candy bar and somebody else is getting a shot, as they call them, for liquor through these little things. So I am going to pull out some of our stuff and get to the councilwoman. And as you know, you talk about the 28 you have in a small area. We've been through here, and it's just sad when the law changes and we have to revisit these things. Which brings me to the point of education, and we all know that two members of the SRC announced that they are going to be gone in short order, step down, and that's another issue that we want to mention, because you know we introduced a bill that passed and it went on the ballot that dealt with the public and how they felt about the SRC and how they felt about our representation. So now we're here again, but this time we're grateful they did, but these are exciting times because it gives us a chance and the public a chance to talk about what is going to happen in public education and what's going to happen with our representation and what level will exist with the School Reform Commission, with that board, and with the public, and with local representation. So I'm looking forward to this dialogue that will happen between us, the administration, and the governor on where we go from here with the School District of Philadelphia, and can't wait for us to have our first discussions all together. Thank you all, colleagues.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Thank you so much. I'm sure we'll hear a lot more on that issue. Chair recognizes Councilman Jones.
Thank you, Mr. President. In these chambers today, we've talked about criminal justice, poverty, slavery, kidnapping, international trade agreements, living wage, sexual harassment, stop and goes, red and blue states between Republicans. I want to lighten it up a little bit. Yesterday, I had a really good day. We had midweek. We had a lot of good things going on. The high point of my day was in Hestonville at a rain garden, redone, a vacant lot that was trash-strewn. A lot of bad things happened on that lot. Commissioner Debbie McCartney from the Water Department, people from Cahill from Parks and Recs, all of them got together and transformed about a quarter of an acre into one of the nicest places on earth. We had a mural that was used tile and the natural light to glisten off of it. I had to touch the mural. It was like transformative. We had a gazebo put out there. We had rainwater bioretention basins added. It stops a four-corner intersection from flooding. It was beautiful. And when I say to you that I'm truly thankful, it took 4 years of Morgan Cephas started on the project when she first got here, and by the time yesterday it was completed, but it was worth the wait. And I want to encourage all my colleagues, If you aren't taking advantage of the water department's ability to transform lots and save rainwater runoff, you should, because it improved the quality of life in that neighborhood, Hestonville. It increased the property values in all of the circumference of the lot. It was awesome. So if you're not doing anything, or particularly my at-large counterparts want to come to 55th Heston, right off of Lancaster, you come there. And by the way, Hestonville is the family of Charleston Heston. So it has some historical value beyond just a beautiful place to live, work, and play. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilman. Chair recognizes Councilman Squilla.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just got a quick reminder for tomorrow, Friday at noon. You can join me for the Columbus Day resolution, and then we'll follow by a great Italian lunch over right over in the caucus room. So if anybody's hungry tomorrow here in council. Sunday is the annual parade down South Broad Street. We'll step off of Broad and McKean at 11:30 and then proceed to Marconi Plaza for a great Italian festival. We hope everybody will join us, except for Hurricane Matthew. So it should be a good time.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. That concludes the speeches on behalf of the, with the exception of one more. Huh? Okay, so you're going to do it. Okay.
I'll take care of the adjournment, Mr. President.
That concludes our speeches on the part of the minority and the majority. With that, I'll call on Councilman Heenan for a motion to adjourn.
Thank you, Mr. President. I move that the council stand adjourned until Thursday, October 13, 2016 at 10 a.m.
Thank you. It's been moved and properly seconded. The council stand adjourned until Thursday, October 13, 2016, 10 a.m. All those in favor say aye. Opposed. Thank you all very much.